Coming up on this edition of Out of the Blue from Middle Tennessee State University, we'll introduce you to our new head men's basketball coach, Nick McDevitt, and discuss the excitement surrounding his arrival to lead the Blue Raiders. We'll talk about a natural aspect of motherhood that's as old as life itself, breastfeeding, and the work by one of our professors on how it's depicted in the media. And we'll tell you how Music City has become home to a vibrant fashion scene, and how MTSU's apparel design and fashion merchandising students are well positioned for that growth. I'm Andrew Oppmann, and this is Out of the Blue. Welcome to Out of the Blue. I'm Andrew Oppmann. A new era for Middle Tennessee men's basketball has officially begun as Nick McDevitt has moved to Murfreesboro to become the 20th head coach of our Blue Raiders. The Marshall, North Carolina native comes here after 5 years as the head coach of the University of North Carolina at Asheville, where he led his Bulldogs to a 98-66 overall record, which includes three consecutive 20-win campaigns in the last three seasons. His Bulldogs have made three consecutive postseason appearances, starting with the trip to the NCAA tournament in 2016, before making the 2017 CollegeInsider.com tournament and the 2018 National Invitation Tournament. So welcome to Out of the Blue, Coach.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
We're just glad to have you here. And I know this story may have been in the media when you arrived, but I want to take you back to those frantic few days when MTSU started knocking on your door, and you were busy, right? There was a lot going on in your life, right? Why don't you set the stage for us? Tell us what was happening in your life.
Absolutely. It was a wild week, for sure. My wife and I were expecting the birth of our first daughter, our second child, Catherine Ann, on March 22nd. That was a Thursday. I talked to Chris Massaro, the athletic director, that Monday, a few days earlier. And obviously, great interest in the basketball job here at Middle Tennessee. And, you know, a couple of days went by. My wife gives birth at 6:30 on a Thursday night. And on Friday morning, after about 2 hours of sleep in a recliner in a hospital room, I got a phone call from Chris saying, we'd like to have you back over here, but this time on campus. And so at 6:30 on Thursday night, my wife and I had a child. And at 6:30 on Friday night, I was on campus here at Middle Tennessee. So it was a wild 24, 48 hours, but one that we'll definitely look back on with a lot of fond memories.
You know, at your introduction, at your press conference, one of the things that struck me, which I thought was really neat about the continuity between the change in coaches, is that you said Kermit Davis. You spoke with him. He gave you some insight and advice before the offer and even after the offer. Let's talk about that. What did that mean to you?
Well, I've known Kermit for a long time, and definitely during the process, and as you mentioned, since I got hired, have remained in contact with him. I mean, who better to ask as a college basketball coach, but also as a friend, to ask another college basketball coach that's been here for 16 years and done a fantastic job. You know, he's done a lot of wonderful things here at Middle Tennessee, and we're hoping we can continue with that tradition and hopefully grow from there.
Well, Coach Nick, I can tell you just the reaction I've talked to a lot of our faithful and fans. They're just thrilled you're here, and the energy you're already bringing to the scene here is wonderful. One of the things that was told to me when you saw, I guess it must have been really late at night, you were walking through Murphy Center, and you just went, "Wow, I can see myself here. What a great place." What was your reaction to the whole campus?
Well, I think it's just like when we bring young men on their official visit to campus. You know, sometimes that it factor is tough to explain, but you know it when you see it, you know it when you feel it, it just feels right. And that was something that was important to me because I knew that it wasn't just me that was coming over here. It was our family. family. Mm-hmm. It was my wife, Lauren, Cooper, and Katie. And so it had to be the right situation. UNC Asheville is great to me, great to my family. Asheville, North Carolina, it's a wonderful place to live. So if we were going to uproot our family and move somewhere else, everything had to be right about it. And everything has been right here in Murfreesboro.
Now you've been, I've bumped into you at a couple of baseball games. Mm-hmm. Family's still in North Carolina. You're transitioning now. But you've been able to make some connections pretty fast. I saw you connecting with some of the students and our alums and our trustees.
And the play at Tucker?
Yeah. You took in our Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Tell everybody about that. That was like one of the first activities you did on campus.
It was. Definitely worth the price of admission. Really remarkable to see that kind of talent here on this campus. Yeah. I get to see, and a lot of people get to see, the talent on the basketball court. And that's what has to be primarily important for me. But to see the talent that's in this community and on this campus was an awesome thing to see.
Well, the buzz of having you in the crowd on that Sunday day performance was really awesome, because I think it set a signal that you're going to engage in the life of the community of this place. And at your press conference, you talked about that's important for your team too, right?
Absolutely. I think, we want folks to come to the games, whether it's the local community. Those streets, they're two-way streets. It's important for the fans to come here, but it's just as important for us to go out and into the community and get really involved in different organizations. The same thing here on campus. You can walk both ways on the sidewalks, too. And so we want the student body to come to the Murphy Center and see the games. But at the same time, we've got to be willing to walk across campus to Tucker and see plays, to get to the science building, get to other places where people that they go to class with each day, other students on campus, that they're involved in what they do as well. Not everybody likes basketball. I love basketball, but not everybody does. But people will come support their classmates because they know them. They really like them, so they'll support them, even if they're not necessarily basketball fans, if you're going and getting involved in their lives as well.
You know, one of the things, other programs will talk a lot about the sports stats. One stat that resonates to a lot of the viewers of this program is the 100% graduation rate of the active players of our basketball players. And I know you've voiced some strong commitments about that. Talk about the importance of succeeding in the classroom as well as on the basketball court.
Well, it's massively important. These young men, they definitely have aspirations of playing professional basketball. That's important. College basketball is hard. And so if you don't have aspirations and goals of being a professional basketball player, you have no chance to get there. It's hard enough. And to be successful in college, you have to be thinking that way. You have to have those same aspirations and goals in the classroom. You have to want to get your degree, want to graduate from Middle Tennessee here. That's massively important because not all those players, although their goals and aspirations are to play professional basketball, that is really hard. It is a small, small amount that can really make a living and a career out of playing basketball. They've got to have their education to fall back on. And that's what's going to really serve them well over the next 40 years. This is 4 years here at Middle Tennessee, playing basketball, getting your degree. But the things that you do during those 4 years will serve them really well for the next 40.
Talk about, and I am going to ask a sports question, talk about what's going to characterize your brand of basketball. What are we going to see you instill in these players, and what do you want them to shine back to the folks in the stands?
Well, I hope they see a tough team out on the floor, tough-minded, a team that enjoys playing with each other. They're fun to watch. They're guys that dive on the floor for loose balls, take charges, because I want to win every game. And if you're relying just on making shots in the offensive side of the ball, the nights you shoot it bad, you lose. I don't want those nights. There's going to be nights that we don't shoot it particularly well. And I think if you do those other things, you can still find a way to be gritty and grind out some wins. Conversely, though, on the other side of the ball, I prefer an up-tempo style of basketball offensively. And so we'll look to get out and play more up-tempo, perhaps, than they have in the past. But obviously, there's a lot of different ways to do it. Coach Davis was very successful playing his style, his brand of basketball. So I think you just have to be true to yourself, because your players pick up on it if you're trying to do something that somebody else does or likes and you're really not being genuine and true to yourself. So we'll play a little bit quicker, but our players will determine that. I told them we'll play as fast as we can without turning it over. You can't throw the ball to the wrong team. So if we can play up-tempo and limit our turnovers, then we'll play relatively quick.
Well, President McPhee said he was blown away from the first time he met you, and I got to tell you, all of us feel the same way. Coach Nick, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome to our campus.
Thank you very much.
And we'll be right back.
Middle Tennessee State University offers more than 100 master's and doctoral degrees designed for working professionals. Many of MTSU's graduate programs are offered partially or completely online. More information is available at mtsu.edu/graduate. Do you want the advantages of a major university with the Ivy League experience of an honors college? What you're looking for is right in front of you. Middle Tennessee State University's beautiful campus is home to over 140 majors taught in state-of-the-art facilities. Our undergraduates get hands-on experience, working alongside a highly respected and caring faculty. Take a closer look. Become True Blue.
Your MTSU Alumni Association has a goal of placing this pin on the lapel of all those who call this campus theirs. Let's pass that tradition on.
Let's pass it on.
Don't underestimate me.
Don't count me out.
Don't block my runway.
We are Middle Tennessee State University.
I work harder than the rest.
I set the tone.
I am True Blue.
Focused on the future, the School of Music at Middle Tennessee State University is home to music industry veterans and offers you a myriad of performance opportunities. A music degree minutes from Nashville, Music City, USA, mtsu.edu/music. Middle Tennessee State University offers more than 100 master's and doctoral degrees designed for working professionals. Many of MTSU's graduate programs are offered partially or completely online. More information is available at mtsu.edu/graduate.
Pass the tradition on.
Pass the tradition on.
Pass it on!
Symbols are important. They represent a pledge and a promise. You've committed yourself to many important things in your life. It's time to add one more. At Middle Tennessee State University, we make a pledge to you. We'll be there to help you reach your goals and keep the promises you've made. Become red, white, and true blue.
Welcome back to Out of the Blue. I'm Andrew Oppmann. A natural aspect of motherhood, as old as human life itself, has not always been depicted favorably or even realistically in the media. That's one of the messages of a book, Breastfeeding and Media, Exploring Conflicting Discourses That Threaten Public Health, written by Dr. Katie Foss, an associate professor of media studies in our School of Journalism and Strategic Media. Welcome to Out of the Blue.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Fascinating work you're doing here. And I'd like for, if you could, just for our viewers to summarize what it took to put this book together. I understand it's hundreds of examinations of different media of all type that explores how this has been covered.
Right, so I looked at everything from 18th century ads for wet nurses all the way through social media posts about breastfeeding, examining all the different ways that media has constructed for the public these messages about breastfeeding. And this included reality television, fictional television, magazine coverage. I looked at books for new parents. I also looked at books for children who are expecting a sibling. And just looking at, the different ways that what we've conceived of breastfeeding through media.
Talk a little bit about the conflicts that are out there in the media. How is it portrayed positively, but also how is it portrayed negatively? And I think it's more the negative portrayal that has been more concerning, correct?
I would agree with that. Well, and overall, at least contemporary media is portraying breastfeeding as fairly positively, at least for a certain type of woman with a certain type of child. A new mother, usually Caucasian, professional, educated, breastfeeding her newborn in the hospital or at home in a private space, is a positive depiction that we see. Leaving out what we're not seeing, which is women of color breastfeeding, although that area is getting a little bit better with representations, or positive representations of women breastfeeding older babies or toddlers, despite the World Health Organization's recommendation that children should be breastfed till at least two. Mm-hmm. What we're not seeing is positive depictions of women breastfeeding in public. And certain acts of breastfeeding being framed as deviant, or breastfeeding as portrayed as too difficult without presenting solutions to common obstacles like thrush or mastitis. So that's really what I've seen across time and across media platforms.
If you can narrow it down to two or three big surprises that you saw and this went, wow, this is a seminal moment in the perception of breastfeeding, and maybe this has helped shape perceptions.
I was actually surprised at some of the more positive depictions in that, because I expected to find more negative depictions, particularly when breastfeeding rates were lower in the 20th century, 1950s to 1970s. Instead of seeing, overtly negative messages about breastfeeding, there aren't a lot of messages about breastfeeding, but occasionally, for example, there'd be a magazine article that would mention breastfeeding.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the most surprising findings across time and across platforms that I observed was that, formula companies, especially, which kind of underscore this whole thing, don't directly say don't breastfeed. Mm-hmm. That's not where we get these conflicting discourses. Instead, it's yes, you should breastfeed, but when it fails, here's some formula to help you out, to kind of save the day.
Almost like it's an inevitable.
Absolutely. And
act.
And that's something that starts as early as, the early 1900s. We start to see in articles and in magazine articles, particularly the formula ads, those kind of messages start as early as the formula ads started. So mid 1800s, you start to see when breastfeeding fails, luckily, we have these milk substitutes, the rescue, that's what they called it in that era.
So Dr. Foss, what are some of the things that workplaces like MTSU should be doing to make breastfeeding more accessible and easier?
Well, there's a number of different ways that MTSU can support breastfeeding. One way is our new Mother's Room on campus in the June Anderson Center for Women, which is fantastic, that especially students have a place to go where they can express their milk and they can feel safe doing so and have a private space. So just providing facilities, but also promoting the new Mother's Room so that students know about it, mm-hmm. so that faculty and staff know about it, so that they can help guide students. But other ways would be just cultural attitudes, making sure that students, faculty, and staff know that everyone has the right to breastfeed in public, mm-hmm. that you're protected legally, and that we need to culturally support everyone in this endeavor. We are in this together, instead of ridiculing women who are breastfeeding in public.
Now, I would be remiss if I didn't tell or give you the opportunity to tell. How can people find your book?
Well, there's actually a couple different ways. It's on Amazon. It's also on the Barnes & Noble website. And then finally, my publisher's website, Palgrave Macmillan, also has a copy of the book.
Available right now.
Yes, it is.
Well, the book is Breastfeeding in Media. Dr. Katie Foss, thank you so much for joining us on Out of the Blue.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back.
Middle Tennessee State University offers more than 100 master's and doctoral degrees designed for working professionals. Many of MTSU's graduate programs are offered partially or completely online. More information is available at mtsu.edu/graduate. Do you want the advantages of a major university with the Ivy League experience of an honors college? What you're looking for is right in front of you. Middle Tennessee State University's beautiful campus is home to over 140 majors taught in state-of-the-art facilities. Our undergraduates get hands-on experience, working alongside a highly respected and caring faculty. Take a closer look. Become True Blue.
Your MTSU Alumni Association has a goal of placing this pin on the lapel of all those who call this campus theirs. Let's pass that tradition on.
Let's pass it on.
Don't underestimate me.
Don't count me out.
Don't block my runway.
We are Middle Tennessee State University.
I work harder than the rest.
I set the tone.
I am True Blue.
Focused on the future, the School of Music at Middle Tennessee State University is home to music industry veterans and offers you a myriad of performance opportunities. A music degree minutes from Nashville, Music City, USA, mtsu.edu/music. Middle Tennessee State University offers more than 100 master's and doctoral degrees designed for working professionals. Many of MTSU's graduate programs are offered partially or completely online. More information is available at mtsu.edu/graduate.
Pass the tradition on.
Pass the tradition on.
Pass it on!
Welcome back to Out of the Blue. I'm Andrew Oppmann. People tend to think of New York and Los Angeles as fashion capitals, and for good reason. But it's time to add Nashville to that short list. Over the past decade, Music City has become home to a vibrant, internationally recognized fashion scene that's full of independent boutiques, fresh designers, and more importantly, the infrastructure needed to support it. For the up-and-coming MTSU apparel design and fashion merchandising students, the timing of this growth couldn't be better. Here to tell us all about it is Rick Cottle, Assistant Professor of Textiles, Merchandising, and Design here at MTSU. Professor.
Yes, sir.
Welcome to Out of the Blue. This is great stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So let's set the scene for me. Tell me about this industry and why MTSU is so well positioned to prepare students for it.
All right. The apparel industry, many people don't know this, but it is the second largest consumer good in the entire world. It drives the world economy. Clothing, our food is number one, mm-hmm. clothing's number two, and housing's number three. So worldwide, it's a huge industry. However, in Middle Tennessee, it is growing like leaps and bounds. There's an economic impact study done several years ago, 2016, I think it was. And they said in 2015, the apparel industry or the fashion industry was about $6 billion in Middle Tennessee, employing about 15,000 people. Mm-hmm. By 2025, that's projected just in Middle Tennessee to be a little over $10
billion. Wow, and that's a jump.
And employ about 25,000 people. So it's gonna be, and not only is it big now, mm-hmm. but it's the number one growth industry in Middle Tennessee, recognized TVA, Mayor Nashville, and Governor's Office have participated in that study.
So because of that growth in Nashville, we've got a lot of connections to Nashville on this. Talk about what you've done to help build our ties to the growing fashion industry in Nashville itself. I know we're participating with a lot of organizations and events.
Sure. There's two major organizations right now. The main organizations are Nashville Fashion Week, who's mm-hmm. been around for about 8 years. They kind of sprung out of New York Fashion Week. So we slowly but surely started working with these people and seeing the value for mm-hmm. our students and them seeing the value coming from MTSU. And then there's another organization called the Nashville Fashion Alliance. They are an organization that functions throughout the year, and it's their mission to create the infrastructure in Middle Tennessee that supports the fashion business. So those two organizations kind of they complement each other very well. Many people that are involved in one are involved in both.
Mm-hmm. Can you define for me what is Nashville style? And I'm betting that it's going to bust what a lot of stereotypes are out there thinking that it's country western. It's not that. No. But does Nashville have a defined style that's different than New York, that's different than Los Angeles, or is it really just a collection of creative individuals of every direction you could possibly think of gathering in a place that feeds off their creativity?
I think your last statement there is exactly what it is. Mm. Nashville, of course, is known as the country music capital of the world, and everyone assumes that when you come to Nashville that it's all country music. Well, we all know that, you know, the Rolling Stones have recorded here for years and Bob Dylan spent lots of time here. As far as the style goes from a fashion and apparel, you know, it's not all cowboy boots and hats and nudie suits, which were what Porter Wagoner used to wear with the sequins and everything. So that's really that country style is still a really big part of it. But actually, I had a student that asked me the other day that we were going. She was going to be going up to Nashville, and asked me, how should I dress? What should be my image? I said, in Nashville, you'll see the country. You will see, Armani suits and Hugo Boss suits. You're going to see really high fashion. You're going to see cut off shirts, tattoos, and chains. But I said, whatever you do, be yourself. This is Nashville. Be yourself and do it on purpose. Make it look like it's on purpose. And that's the Nashville style. You'll see all those ranges at every one of the functions.
Wow.
Yeah.
You've had many alums that are successful. I'm not trying to limit it just to one.
Sure.
But one has recently been in the news.
Oh, yeah.
And why don't you tell us a little bit more about her and how she gained some national exposure through a really popular television show.
Sure. Her name's Ayanna Ife. A lot of people know her as Ayanna. She was on season 16 of Project Runway after applying, by the way, 5 times.
Mm-hmm.
And so she learned from her experiences in applying and just kept on applying. And then once she got on there, most of the people around here are friends of hers think she was robbed. But that's beside the point.
Because she was a runner-up, not the winner.
Yes, she was a runner-up and not the winner. But she's filling a niche in the market that is modest fashion. She's Muslim. She wears a hijab every day. She lives that life. That's not just her image, that's her life.
Mm-hmm.
She really doesn't want to be known as the Muslim fashion lady, but that's kind of where she's gone, and she solves a lot of problems. But that for the Muslim modest wear that I didn't even know existed.
And you went to New York
during
part of the taping of that, as I understand,
sure.
Right? She asked her friend and mentor to come join her, right?
Yeah, I was surprised. She called and said that she had a couple of, I think there's 4 or 5 spots that she could invite people to come to the finale, which was the actually a runway show at New York Fashion Week. It's where they filmed this. But she invited me to come to New York for that final taping, and that was really an honor. I was there with her mom and 4 of her siblings.
So Ayanna was back on campus too recently as well. I know President McPhee took a selfie with her well.
Sure.
But she was on to participate in the TXMD runway show. Why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. We produce a show every year, and there's one class that's responsible for producing the show. And this year there were 70, including the seniors, probably 120 garments in the show that are every single garment made by a TXMD student.
Wow.
And a design student. And Ayanna came back to participate in the show as a judge, as a matter of fact.
That had to mean a lot.
Oh, yeah. She was really funny because it's weird for her getting to sit on the other side and and do the judging rather than being judged all the time. But she really enjoyed it. She was so gracious. And we actually had another judge, the CEO of the Nashville Fashion Alliance was here, Van Tucker, here to judge as well. So they made a pretty good team of picking our outstanding senior.
So Professor, again, thank you for sharing all this with us, and thanks for being on Out of the Blue.
Thank you for inviting me.
And this does wrap up another edition of Out of the Blue. You can find more stories and videos about the campus 24 hours a day by visiting our website, mtsunews.com. If you haven't visited the site in a bit, check it out. It's been revamped and redesigned with additional content from MTSU Magazine and all our other publications. We also invite you to follow MTSU on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for additional special content. I'm Andrew Oppmann, and I hope you will always remain true blue.